34,000 watched the Cleveland Indians and the Boston Red Sox.
Baseball.
In the first
a game.
Pennant playoff,
America's treasured pastime is made up of home runs, diving catches, and strikeouts. But history has transformed baseball into something much more than just a game. Not long ago, it was the source of a tremendous change in the course of African American history. In the 1940s, bigotry towards African Americans was at an all-time high. Lynch mobs were common. Blacks were denied many of their rights guaranteed by law. Thus far, leaders advocating these rights were largely unsuccessful. However, some reforms began, such as the monumental integration of baseball, which brings to mind the courageous efforts of Jackie Robinson. The American media focused on Robinson, whose career was often tainted by racism. However, 11 weeks after Robinson entered the major leagues, a black man named Larry Doby stepped onto the professional baseball scene unnoticed by many. His career was statistically exceptional, yet beneath the records were countless incidents of racial intolerance, undoubtedly as many as Robinson encountered. Yet his story is ultimately triumphant, not tragic. He persevered and did not let hatred interfere with his display of talent. Lawrence Eugene Doby was born in Camden, South Carolina on December 13, 1923 to David and Etta Doby. He was the only child in a poor, unstable family and was raised by his grandmother. From an early age, Doby exhibited considerable skills in baseball. At 17, while still in high school, Doby was recruited by the Newark Eagles of the Negro Baseball Leagues. Doby played second base for the Newark Eagles for 2 years. After a two-year term in the United States Navy, he returned to the Eagles and helped them defeat the Kansas City Monarchs for the championship in 1946. Doby was ready to move on to bigger and better things. Unbeknownst to him, the eccentric owner of the Cleveland Indians, Bill Veeck, was searching for the right man to integrate the American leagues. On June 28, 1947, the Cleveland Call and Post newspaper discovered that the Indians had made extensive study of Larry Doby. It was reported that the veteran baseball scout, Bill Killifer, had scouted Larry Doby in Brooklyn. On July 4, 1947, 11 weeks after Jackie Robinson became the first African-American Major League Baseball player, Doby signed a contract with Veeck. Doby recalled what Veeck told him at this historic meeting.
No arguing with umpires. Don't even turn around at a bad call at the plate, and no dissertations with opposing players. Either of those might start a race riot.
Veeck also called a meeting among the current members of the team, telling them,
I understand that some of you players said that if a nigger joins the club, you're leaving. Well, you can leave right now because this guy is going to be a bigger star than any guy in this room.
He walked into the clubhouse for the first time, and you know, none of his teammates shook his hand or said anything to him. I mean, that had to be, you know, probably the worst feeling in the world to, you know, be in the clubhouse with some guys that you know that don't like you.
Doby recalled their first interactions similarly.
Some of the players shook my hand, but most of them didn't. It was one of the most embarrassing moments of my life.
After the awkward introduction, the team headed onto the field in Comiskey Park in Chicago for a game against the White Sox. Although the crowd welcomed Doby onto the field, his teammates did not. In preparation for the game, players got together to play catch. Doby, however, was ignored and stood alone with no partner until Joe Gordon, the all-star second baseman, approached Doby and said,
Hey kid, let's warm up.
After Doby's first game, he was not escorted to the whites-only Del Prado Hotel with the rest of the players, but to the DuSable Hotel on the other side of Chicago. Conversely, when Jackie Robinson came to Chicago with the Dodgers, he was permitted to stay in the Del Prado Hotel with his teammates. On the second day of Doby's major league career, Lou Boudreau, manager of the Indians, decided to put Doby in at first base, a position he had never played before in the Negro Leagues. Being a second baseman, Doby lacked the first baseman's glove. An Indians bench coach asked Eddie Robinson, the right-handed first baseman for the Indians, to loan Doby his glove. Robinson replied,
I won't lend my glove to no nigger.
The rest of Doby's season was under par compared to his Negro League days. He mostly pinch hit and appeared in only 29 games. Worse than that was the way that an innocent baseball player was treated.
There was so much hype about Jackie Robinson, there wasn't much left over when it was Larry Doby's turn. The whole country had watched what had happened to Robinson and what was going on. Newspapers had front page headlines everywhere, but when Doby came along, it had already been done.
Nevertheless, Doby persisted in the shadows, which in truth is the triumph of his story. Even in spring training, Doby was segregated from his teammates. Upon arrival in Tucson, Arizona, Doby was separated from the rest of the team, who stayed in the Santa Rita Hotel. Along with racism off the field, he experienced racism on the field. In Lubbock, Texas, Doby was barred from entering the stadium because the gate attendants did not believe that he was a member of the Indians. Also while in Texas, at Texarkana, Doby was bombarded with bottles and other objects while in center field. Manager Boudreaux had to pull him out of the game. When the team traveled to Houston, Doby was booed and insulted as he came to the plate. His response? A 500-foot home run. Doby also remembered how the umpires made discriminatory and unfair calls on him.
Some of them had no love for me. There was a big difference between what they called on Ted Williams and what they'd call on me.
As time went on, his teammates began to accept him as more than just a coworker. The players would joke around with him during games and supported him after bad plays. Later in his career, there was even a day in honor of his integration of the American Leagues. Doby and the rest of the Indians continued to prosper throughout the 1948 season, ending the regular season in a first-place tie with the Boston Red Sox. With Doby's offensive help, the Indians won a single-game playoff against the Sox and found themselves in the World Series against the Boston Braves. After a six-game series, the Indians were victorious. Doby played a key role, batting with a .318 average. In addition to the Indians' World Series championship, something else significant occurred. After the Indians won the fourth game of the series, due to Larry Doby's game-winning home run, Steve Gromick, the white pitcher for the Indians, hugged Larry Doby. A famous photograph captured the event. Doby remembered,
"The picture was more rewarding and happy for me than actually hitting that home run. After being involved in all that segregation, the picture finally showed a moment of a man showing his feelings for me."
I think at that point, people started looking in the box scores as, did Doby do well today, not thinking about who he was, but just as another ball player.
In the first half of the 1949 season, Doby was voted onto the American League All-Star team. At this time, there were five blacks in the majors. Doby noticed that four out of the five black players in the major leagues made the All-Star team, which, according to him, was
proof that for a black man to play in the majors, he had to be much better than a white player.
Perhaps the vilest form of racism was in a game against the Philadelphia Athletics. Years later, Doby remembered the event.
"Once, as I slid into second base, the guy playing shortstop spit on me, but I walked away from it."
Despite the harassment, Doby played well for the remainder of the season, leading the team in home runs, runs batted in, and runs. Doby's statistics throughout the rest of 1950 were solid, as well as in 1951, 52, and 53. At the beginning of 1954, in spring training, Doby was finally admitted into the Santa Rita Hotel in Tucson, but he could not sit in the lobby or use the elevator. Tragic elements of Doby's story were the times that the racism became too much. Sometimes, when he felt the umpire's call was biased, he would point to the back of his hand, indicating that his color was a factor in the call. Once, the racial obscenities yelled at him by fans became too much. Doby grabbed a bat and charged towards the stands, but he was luckily restrained by a teammate. Even worse, he landed a left hook on Art Dittmar, a pitcher who had thrown at his head. This incited a bench-clearing brawl. While they did indeed happen, these incidents were not the norm. Doby generally kept his composure throughout the racism. Doby was traded multiple times and eventually retired in 1959 with the White Sox. He then played professional baseball in Japan and went on to coach the White Sox in 1978, coincidentally becoming the second ever black manager in baseball. A passionate, sensitive, and determined man, he refused to let ubiquitous doubt overcome his belief in himself and his cause.
You know, he couldn't fail. He had to be a great player, you know, because that would have been it.
The success of Larry Doby lies in his determination through all obstacles he encountered. Nearly 40 years after his retirement, and only 5 years before his death, Doby was inducted into the National Baseball Hall of Fame, class of 1998. But this tardy recognition means little next to his contributions towards the integration of baseball.
Of course, you had Robinson, but to have, you could say, well, one player, maybe that was a fluke, that this one just happens to be the best player in the Negro Leagues, and there really aren't other guys. Doby was there to prove that that's not true.
His remarkable lifetime statistics are something to marvel, but they fail to rival the incredible tale of a man who just wanted to play the game at the level he deserved. As a Negro Leaguer, he once watched an Indians game with a scout and declared,
"There's nothing I can't do down there."
While thousands, maybe millions, disagreed, Larry Doby persevered and grew to become a triumphant and legendary figure in American history.